Well, at first glance, this looks like your neighbourhood car accessory shop, doesn't it? That lovely place you go to on Saturday mornings for your gadgets and spares. But here, you might be more than a little surprised at what you will find. You can buy a new silencer, for example, but it'll look like that. You can buy wheels and tyres, but they will be highly polished alloy rims. And 10-inch wide Fat Herbies, like that one. It's all part of a booming new market in car customising. Customising, or hot-rodding, like the terminology in much of the hardware, started on the streets of Los Angeles and San Francisco. Nowadays, hot rods and custom cars are common on British roads. Machines like this transit van, which started life as a dull delivery hack and ended up as a mobile luxury apartment. Or this 1949 Ford Pilot, once the family car which took our mums and dads to Southend, now a fearsome flame-painted roadster. This Cortina is still recognisable as Ford's million-selling family transport, though now it's a jacked-up and spoiled moving art gallery. And what about this? When Henry Ford introduced the Model T as the world's first production car, he could hardly have imagined that it would one day look like this. Chromed 400-horsepower V8 engine, E-type rear suspension, and enough rubber to shoe a Grand Prix car. It looks an eccentric freak.
But are they freaks? Just oddball one-offs? Or are these the test beds for tomorrow's styling ideas, destined to find their way into every high street in the country? Already, a flourishing customising industry is growing up. These premises of the Wolf Race organisation, where they finish Wolf Race wheels, are hardly the backstreet workshops of a small cult activity. Pete Darwell has won a number of prizes for his car designs. Pete, the guy brings in his car, and there you have it. Where on earth do you begin?
Well, the guy comes to us and gives us a rough idea of what he actually wants. We take it from there and try and create something on paper for him so he can see the sort of finished job he's going to get. And given his approval, we then go ahead with the job.
But you get a free hand in what you do for
him?
Yes,
he more or less gives just a rough idea, but sort of 75% of the idea is ours in the end.
And when you've done that, is it out with the pots and brushes?
Oh, no, it's all done with special airbrush spray guns.
Which is that sort of thing?
This gun here, yes. It's a very fine spray achieved by using this gun, and it's ideal for sort of the sort of work you see in this car with murals.
And have you found that the big manufacturers are picking up your customising painting ideas at all?
Well, they're certainly getting turned on very slowly. They're using more of the sort of types of colours we use, which are very translucent colours, which change colour in certain lights. And I think they're going to go on to sort of accentuating body panels by using perhaps one solid colour, as you see to the top of this car, and a few pin lines here and there.
There's a lot of work there, Pete. When you've finished it, how does the owner look after it? How does he protect it?
Well, we hope he looks after it well, but the best way is just to wash it regularly with, you know, good clean water and use a good wax. That's the only thing you can do.
How much does it cost? How much did this car cost to do this?
Well, this particular job involved flaring in spoilers, front and rear, set of wheels, exhaust side pipes, and the paint job. It came to about £1,000.
And at that price, a lot of owners couldn't afford it. Can you do it yourself?
You can do. The easiest method and the cheapest method is to buy the stick-on do-it-yourself murals. These come in various sort of forms and different scenes, and they simply just stick to the bodywork, which does give you something a bit different. But if you want a really good-looking job and a professional job, it's best to get a garage to do it for you.
John Hine is from Car Product Planning at Ford's. John, how closely do you study the customised market and adapt it to your own needs at Ford's?
Well, we're following all market trends very closely. I believe, as far as customising is concerned, that the more manufacturers are forced to produce cars very much the same in very high volume, the greater will be the demand for individual expression in the car.
But Mark, Hugh, it's self-defeating, isn't it? If this comes down a customer, if down the production line, and you're selling them in such volume, it's no longer a customised car.
Well, I think some of the more extrovert jobs that we've seen today could never be produced on the production line anyway. The manufacturing process would not permit it. so that these sorts of things will always remain individual.
I suppose you are customising to a degree already, aren't you?
Well, yes, I think that's true. We have fairly strong roots in European motorsport. We've been in racing and rallying for a number of years, and the sorts of things that you see on our production cars today, the front and rear spoilers, the alloy wheels and the big tyres, have come directly from that motorsport involvement.
What about the van side of it? Because I know this isn't really your scene at Ford's, the van side, but that was a very interesting, that transit van. Do you think there's a market in that for customising vans?
Well, I think perhaps there is more commercial potential in the van than perhaps in some of the more transatlantic imports that we've seen in car customising, simply because there is no competition of any kind for the vehicle that we've seen today.
And the van is a very plain thing, isn't it?
Well, basically it's a very plain, boring workhorse. Yeah. I can see people, perhaps boutique operators, people like that, who require something that is strongly individual to promote their own image in the marketplace, catching on to things like the custom van as a PR statement.
Yeah, right. Because I can see the day coming when to customise really would just to have a plain black Model T Ford, can't you?
Well, you never know. It's been done before.
John Hine, thank you very much. In the States, the major manufacturers are already sitting up and taking notice of customising trends. These are the current small van and truck brochures from Ford and from General Motors. They're the equivalents of the Transit Bedford CF vans over here. You've got fancy paint, fancy wheels, tinted glass, porthole windows. Could it happen here? We're already halfway there. Steve Stringer here runs Star Vans here in Bedford. This highly modified Transit is one of his products. Steve, I understand you're going to go into production with a van like this. We can actually buy it from you, right?
We can't buy it from us. We're actually selling through the General Ford and GM dealers.
Oh, you're only going through dealers with it?
Yes, most definitely.
Now, what's the price? Four grand all in, is it?
It works out basically around £4,000, as you see it here. This is including the cost of the basic vehicle.
Now, what sort of person is going to buy this sort of van? What do you get for your money for a start?
Basically, you get a basic Transit or CF van. Then we take it, we add the custom paint. We add the totally insulated wood paneled interior, shag pile carpet from rear to the front area. The front includes two high back swivel seats with armrests. We put the mag wheels and tyres outside. We put the side appearance pipes on. This, if you was to buy it individually, would cost you somewhere in the region of £2,000 extra. But because we've tied a deal up with the Ford dealers and the GM dealers, we're offering this whole packet for around about £1,000 over and above the average price of a van.
So, coming back to the customer, who's going to buy a van with your wood panelling and your shag pile carpet?
I think the young person, the middle-aged person that wants not a motor caravan, wants a vehicle they can drive every day of the week, they can use it, the small trader that wants the average person on the street to recognise that Uncle Tom's butchery has got a really super van that he's driving around in and using it for his public relations.
Yeah, I can't think what would happen to your shag pile carpet with Uncle Tom's butchery hanging in here, but nevertheless. What about overseas? Are you going to the overseas market?
We are now spending a lot of time in Europe setting up deals with the European market. We've had a lot of inquiries from the Arab market.
And what sort of vans are they ordering?
Very, very expensive ones,
in
the excess of £20,000.
And are you only working on British vans, like your Transits and your Bedford CFs?
We're working on anything, but basically, I think the major conversion is on the Ford Transit because it's so very much like the American Ford Econoline, which the whole thing started from in 1964, 1965.
What about the manufacturers? How do they view your, well, not plagiarising their vans, but adapting their vans?
The manufacturers, especially Ford Motor Company, are looking at it in the fact that in America it's very big business. Taking England, we have a very, very quick-thinking Ford dealer in Manchester that is actually setting up England's first custom van centre. It's totally devoted to custom vans, custom van-in, custom vehicles. They're going into a leisure market, which is something like, on the scale of America, where Friday comes and everyone is forgetting about work, They're interested in throwing the fishing rod in the back, hooking the boat up to the back. Off they go, weekend away, wife and kids, fantastic.
Steve, you've sold me, I like it. Good luck with you.
Well, that could be just the beginning. We're already getting whispers that one of the big three van makers in the UK is planning to build an off-the-peg custom van like this one with the next model change. Now, I wonder who that could be. They do say the Transit range must be due for a revamp before too long. One thing we do know is that Ford are not considering restarting the Model T production line to build replica hot rods like this one, belonging to Eddie Wimble. Eddie built this T bucket, as it's called, 3 years ago for his own fun. Now, interest in hot rodding has grown so much that Eddie's going into production, so anyone can order their very own 1923-style machine in the middle of 1977. Price? Well, up to £6,000.